developments are pending on the world's air routes, and the new all-metal flying boats being built at Rochester for Imperial Airways are Britain's stake in the forthcoming struggle for commercial air supremacy. 29 of these huge air vessels are being constructed, and the most advanced of them, the Canopus, over which we are passing, is for experimental transatlantic work. They dwarf any other airliners in operation. Movie turn will be showing. The first of the new Empire flying boats is on the slipway, a giant luxury liner of the air. From her nose to her super streamlined tail, a marvel in this age of marvels. Points of interest, four engines of 900 horsepower each, 18 tons in weight, accommodation for 24 passengers and a crew of five, top speed 200 miles an hour. A wonderful machine and solid evidence of British aerial enterprise. 28 sisters are being built at Rochester in Britain's ambitious program for the country.
Well, Major Brackley, here's the certificate of airworthiness for you.
And flying the Blue Peter, for Canopus is ready to sail, or rather to take off and fly. The first of the new Empire mail flying boats receives her crew and casts off. The giant Imperial Airways machine is leaving Rochester en route for the Mediterranean, where she will assume duty as the most important link to be forged in modern empire communication. With a beautiful takeoff, she gets into the air. Movie turn aloft in a 150-mile-an-hour plane is soon outdistanced by the amazingly powerful flying boat. Alexandria to Marseille, from Marseille to Southampton. Britain's new giant flying boat Caledonia wings in with Christmas mails. Making a landing which is as graceful as her bulk will allow, she has all the appearance of a flying whale, and from her hull she disgorges sack after sack of presents and greetings from overseas. Welcome communications, even if the best tidings from Australia come over. Transatlantic rhythm. At Fines, the Caledonia is ready to start in her test flight to Newfoundland. President De Valera takes time off from his election campaign to wish Captain Wilcoxon and his crew a happy landing on the other side. The schedule is on, and in not too pleasant weather, the giant flying boat takes off on a hop of nearly 2,000 miles. Up in the air, the captain flies the plane while the first officer navigates. They fly low on a southerly course with headwinds most of the way. The Caledonia arrives on schedule. Meanwhile, winging in from Newfoundland comes the American Clipper, having flown the herring pond by a more northerly route, high above the clouds with the following wind. She makes a perfect landing, and by this double triumph, the aerial conquest of the Atlantic becomes a reality. Captain Gray and his men come ashore, where they are welcomed by Mr. De Valera.
Congratulate you on behalf of the Secretary of State. We regard you as flying ambassadors on this trip, Captain.
Thank you very much.
On behalf of myself and my crew and my company, I wish to thank everybody who has come here to meet us. We had a very successful trip. The first part of it was rather rainy, but not too bad. But since arriving over this side, we've had perfect weather, and there's been nothing to worry about at all. I wish to thank everybody very, very much indeed.
Thank you. are taking Cambria over to the Shannon today to make some tests at the new airport there. We want to make contact with the meteorological and wireless stations that have been erected there by the Irish Free State.
Captain Pearl, Cambria's pilot, is flying her on the test flight. Following the successful trips to Alexandria and round the British Isles, preparation for the Atlantic service reaches another stage. The testing of the wireless and meteorological equipment established in Ireland. She takes off from Southampton in a squall, but the dirty weather in no way impedes the mighty Empire flying boat. She's on her way, and transatlantic air travel draws nearer. While the American clipper ship takes off from Long Island, New York, the British plane Cavalier is leaving Bermuda on her pioneer flight. We'll follow the Cavalier to Long Island. Each country is starting the New York-Bermuda service simultaneously in a partnership enterprise, and the Cavalier completes the 780-mile ocean trip in just under 6 hours, the first British commercial plane ever to land in American territory. Her crew come ashore after the historic flight, and her pilot, Captain Cumming, acts as spokesman for them.
We arrived here according to our schedule, and have been rather overwhelmed by the reception which...
Tragedy again, this time off the coast of America. Here the Imperial Airways flying boat Cavalier is ending one of her flights from Bermuda to Long Island. Alas, on another such flight, outward bound to Bermuda, her engines failed and she was forced to come down in heavy weather 150 miles out at sea. Wireless told the whole story. By wireless, the position of the great liner was learnt. Wireless announced the rescue of her survivors by the American tanker S.O. Baytime.
The crash of a mighty flying boat. Clawed down by fog, snow and gale, the Imperial Airways airliner Capricornus lies on the wooded slopes near Mâcon in France, a mass of wreckage. Four members of the crew and one woman passenger lost their lives. The flying boat was on her maiden voyage, outward bound to Alexandria. Tenth of the type which is linking Britain with the Empire, Capricornus met with disaster when terrible weather prevented her reaching an emergency landing base.
Centaurus makes big flying boat news when, commanded by Captain Burgess, she prepares to leave Southampton on her 30,000-mile survey flight to New Zealand. Hers will be the longest trip ever undertaken by a commercial aircraft, and she'll be flying over the proposed air route to the Dominion and back. The scope of these machines only emphasizes the rarity of such a tragic accident as that of the Cygnus at Brindisi.
The boat moves off to gather way down the smooth stretches of Sydney Harbour. They're travelling luxury in the sky. And in a flying boat, they have the utmost in safety, airworthy and seaworthy too. Round the world travel in the modern manner. It's the dawn of a new day in Australia's communications with the world. To England by flying boat, and away she flies. At dawn, the Qantas makes ready for her takeoff to England. Friends on the jetty watch passengers embarking for this historic voyage, the first regular 10-day airmail and passenger service from Australia to England. Qantas officials chat happily until another flight finishes as the British Empire flying boat Challenger lands gracefully on Sydney Harbour, bringing passengers and airmail from England. The flying boat service are back at last. A new race of ships spanning the Empire, bringing the Antipodes closer to the mother country.